Most people, including me, would never want to mess with a venomous snake. But Jim Harrison wrangles snakes every day. And this is no joke. He's been bitten multiple times and has a few fingers missing to prove it. So why does he do it? To get this. This tiny bit of liquid could save lives.
It took five animals to do this. And if you get bit, it'll cost you part of your body or close to $500,000 in medical bills.
It's a key component in making anti-venom, the serum used to treat deadly snake bites. And that anti-venom is kind of hard to come by. We'll explain why. This is what it takes. Looking at weird jobs that have an impact and the curiously inclined people who do them.
I was a police officer for 5 years till I got run over by a stolen car, did some bounty hunting. I was a professional kickboxer, but 43 years ago, I started extracting venom, and I've been doing it ever since.
Jim houses thousands of snakes at the Kentucky Reptile Zoo that he runs with his wife, Kristen Wiley.
I do 90% of the work.
Yeah, she does.
Visitors to the zoo go into three buildings that are open to the public. And then we have 11 other buildings that are not open to the public that house the majority of the animals that are used for venom production.
I'm going to take this snake out and hopefully put him down there.
Oh, he is really excited. I'm not real fond of that.
Yeah, he's real hungry.
Every day, Jim and Kristen handle the world's most venomous snakes, such as rattlesnakes, mambas, vipers, and king cobras like this one.
Sorry.
Together, they're risking their lives to save others.
Don't come back out.
So what does it take to extract venom? Discipline. Jim spends hours every day maintaining his physical health. And before every extraction session, Jim takes a moment to clear his head.
I live a very Bushido type lifestyle, and that is, when I wake up in the morning, I'm prepared to die. I know that death is there, so I can't let my mind wander. I have to be focused just on what I'm doing.
Okay, snake venom extraction. First, get out the snake. Don't get bit. Then, set it on this mat and pin its head down. Grab its head and place its fangs over this glass funnel. Massage its head until venom comes out. Put the snake back and repeat a half dozen times. From there, the venom goes to the lab, where Kristen freeze-dries it and preps it for shipping. This material can be used in making anti-venom, which the World Health Organization says is in short supply in the developing world due to their high cost and relatively poor healthcare systems. So how's it made? Well, that part is kind of nuts.
It's made by giving venom to a host animal. Most places in the world use horses. Those animals produce antibodies for the venom, and then those antibodies are essentially what you get as anti-venom.
Kristen says there's less than 40 places in the whole world that produce venom. So their work is a rare part of a critically important system for getting anti-venom where it's needed the most. And it's not just about anti-venom. Today, their venom is going to research labs, where it's studied for its potential to treat cancer, lupus, Alzheimer's, and other diseases. And since Jim lives off his police pension, the money they get from their venom goes right back into running the zoo.
Most people, when they think of venoms and they think of stuff, they think of death, and I think of life because it saves more lives than it'll ever take.
We need to realize that all of this biodiversity out there is what's keeping us alive. It's part of the machinery of the planet.
So for Jim, at the end of the day, it's not about showing off or taking risks. It's about helping people.
When I was a police officer, a lot of the guys who used to work for me said I was the first one through the door. It wasn't because I was looking for danger or death or any of that stuff. It was because I didn't want somebody else to get hurt.
If you like this video and you want to see more, then give us a like, subscribe to Freethink, and you'll see all of our latest stuff in your newsfeed.